Hello and welcome back to 202 Decades. This is our first end of century episode. It's about the first century. Rather than discussing what happened in one specific decade, I'll be using these periodic episodes as a chance to review the prior century, talk about trends that might be too gradual to pop into the narrative, discuss daily life, and generally broaden the discussion. The use of decades as a framework already means we are looking at history fairly zoomed out. But in these episodes, we'll zoom out even further to see greater structures. This is the first of three end-of-century episodes. The first is a summary of the first century and two trends going on in the background. The second will cover listener questions, and the third will cover society outside of the upper echelons. Here's what we're covering this time. Part 1, summary. Part 2, growing imperial power. And part 3, offense or defense. Part 1, summary. I've attempted to summarize the first century of Western history succinctly here, but this was more challenging than I expected. What do you cut out, and what do you keep? My first attempt was over 15 minutes long. Here's a briefer 6-minute version. In the first century, quote, Western history and the Roman Empire were synonymous. When the century began, Augustus was emperor. His preferred title was princeps, though, meaning first citizen. In theory, he was just the member of the Senate who secured stability for the empire. He had had this role since 27 BC. He worked to extend the borders of the empire to natural limits and find a suitable successor. He only partly achieved these goals. His attempts to extend the border of the empire from the Rhine to the Elbe River in Germany failed when his new governor and 3 legions were ambushed and killed by the local Germans. He outlived his preferred successors, eventually settling for his son-in-law, Tiberius. After Augustus had died in 14 AD, Tiberius ruled for over 2 decades. He continued the stability of Augustus, but became tired of the squabbling of the Senate and retreated from Rome. Tiberius's nephew, Germanicus, campaigned in Germania and restored confidence to the army after their defeat by the Germans. He seemed destined to be a great ruler of Rome until he mysteriously died. Some blamed Tiberius for his death. During Tiberius's reign, Jesus of Nazareth taught, was crucified, and then rose from the dead, if you believe his followers. Tiberius was succeeded by Caligula. Everyone was excited about having this son of Germanicus as their leader, but things went downhill quickly. Caligula was depraved and cruel. The imperial bodyguard, the Praetorians, assassinated him in 41 AD. Next came Claudius, the brother of Germanicus. Although bookish and awkward, Claudius ruled well and kicked off the conquest of Britain. He was poisoned by his last wife, Agrippina, who wanted to see her own son, Nero, become emperor, rather than Claudius's own natural son. Nero was young when he began to rule in 54. He was mostly a figurehead for the first 5 years of his reign. His advisors ruled for him and did well. His mother was slowly pushed out of the inner circle until she was ordered killed for plotting against Nero. In the latter years of his reign, Nero began to govern alone. In this time, he alienated the Senate with his erratic decisions and his fixation on performance, musical, athletic, and theater. During his reign, Rome went to war with the Parthian Empire of Persia for influence in Armenia, and mostly lost. In 66, in Judea, the Jews revolted and threw out their Roman officials. Nero was the last of Augustus's dynasty, the Julio-Claudians. The year 69 was the end of Nero. This year is called the Year of the 4 Emperors. First, a provincial governor named Galba declared against Nero and marched to Rome. The Senate hailed him and made Nero an enemy of the state. Galba reached Rome, but offended just about everyone right away. He was killed after a few months. He was replaced by Otho, but the legions by the Rhine River supported their governor, Vitellius, and together they marched toward Rome. Otho went out to meet them, but he lost the first battle of Bedriacum. Vitellius now became emperor, but Vitellius's support was narrow, and Vespasian, the general Nero had chosen to recapture Judea, gained support. The legions by the Danube River supported Vespasian, and they took it upon themselves to unseat Vitellius. At the Second Battle of Bedriacum, they defeated Vitellius's army and then killed Vitellius as they stormed into Rome. Vespasian now became emperor. His son Titus was left to the campaign in Judea. In 70, his army captured Jerusalem and destroyed the Jewish temple. Vespasian ruled well, with an old-fashioned simplicity and humility. He died in 79, and his son Titus became emperor, just in time to deal with a volcanic eruption, a plague, and a great fire. But he did inaugurate the Colosseum. He died of illness after only 2 years. Vespasian's younger son, Domitian, now became emperor. He didn't get along with the Senate, but he ruled well, if somewhat autocratically. He reinforced the Rhine frontier and fought with the Dacians and other border barbarians. A rebellion against Domitian in 89 made him more paranoid, and he tried to root out subversive elements, suspicious senators, Stoics, and Christians. He reigned from 81 to 96 AD, but was finally killed by servants of his own household. Quickly, the Senate chose old Nerva as the new emperor. Nerva rolled back the clock and treated the Senate as equals, but he didn't have the support of the army. After 1 year, the Praetorians broke into his palace and made demands of him at sword point. Nerva complied. Soon after, he adopted as heir a more popular politician, Trajan. This man had the admiration of the army and the respect of the Senate. Nerva died in 99. Our century ends with Trajan in Rome, just beginning his reign. Part 2, Growing Imperial Power. What trends have we seen over the past 100 years? The first trend that came to mind is one that was broken with Nerva at the end of the century. Since Augustus, the power of the Principate had continued to grow and expand. The entire concept of a princeps was slowly established by Augustus, a relationship between him and the Senate, one that was codified in two settlements. The Senate agreed to these grantings of power because of the decades-long civil wars they had just lived through or died through. Augustus's power was officially granted to him by the Senate, and there was no guarantee, legally, that whoever followed Augustus would continue to hold that power. But Augustus's long reign helped to cement the system into place. When Augustus died, the Senate quickly granted to Tiberius all the powers which Augustus had accumulated only over years of work. The Senate had become accustomed to running all things through the office of the Principate. They had lost the skill to work independently. Tiberius, though, wanted to see the Senate increase its responsibilities and its independence. Neither side met the expectations of the other, a major source of frustration for Tiberius. He went so far as calling the Senate men fit to be slaves. This trend continued with Caligula. He was instantly granted all the rights and powers of his predecessors. But Caligula went further, humiliating the Senate and flaunting his power. Mercifully, he was killed by the Praetorians. Next came Claudius. Here, the Praetorians presented Claudius to the Senate and basically said, acclaim him, with an implied, or else. The trend line is clear here. The Senate was being pushed around by others, but they were still important enough in the Roman psyche that the Praetorians bothered to present Claudius to the Senate at all. Their approval still mattered. Claudius would limit the power of the Senate further, though. Rather than relying on their help to administer, he turned to freedmen secretaries. This practice allowed him to pick men who had shown excellence in administering, ones who were personally loyal to him, instead of senators who might fill the post merely to raise their own prestige. And then came Nero, a dynastic choice who merely received the Senate's rubber stamp of approval. Nero's reign began with the princeps showing little interest in governing, but over time, he increasingly made decisions, often against the express recommendations of the Senate. On top of this, he showed little regard for the opinions of the Senate, instead degrading himself, in their opinion, by publicly performing in music, acting, and athletics. Discontent against Nero grew, not only among the Senate in Rome, but among the governors in the west of the empire, who admittedly were mostly of the senatorial class. When Galba rebelled, he was declared emperor by the Senate before he even reached Rome. Then, once he had been killed, Otho was hailed as emperor. But then Vitellius defeated Otho and was recognized as emperor. Finally, troops loyal to Vespasian defeated Vitellius, and Vespasian was acclaimed emperor. You can see in each of these convolutions, the Senate was one step behind. Recognizing, hailing, acclaiming, but not choosing. Several of these contestants weren't even in Rome when they were voted on by the Senate. Galba hadn't made it to Italy yet. Vitellius was with his army at Bedriacum, and Vespasian was loitering in Alexandria. The year of the four emperors was a clear signal that power, real power, lay not in the Senate, but with whomever had the loyalty of the armies. When things settled down with Vespasian ruling, the Senate may have felt more secure. Vespasian gave lip service to the senators. He honored their special status. We must remember that Vespasian was unique, however. First, he could not trace his heritage back to the deified Augustus, whom the Senate had transferred its power to. No, his was a new dynasty, one based on military power. Not only was the dynasty new, but it was lowborn. Vespasian was not of senatorial birth. He had been specifically chosen by Nero to lead the campaign in Judea because Nero feared giving command to someone of the senatorial class. He feared a highborn person given command of the campaign would be able to rebel and gain support to challenge him. Vespasian wouldn't pose such a threat. Ironically, though, this equestrian-born Vespasian would be the last man standing in the game of emperor. He was the first of the emperors born from outside the senatorial class. The Senate was willing to accept this arrangement because of Vespasian's support by the legions and his deference to the honor of the Senate. His son, Titus, during his short reign, continued this practice of honoring the Senate. When Domitian came to rule, however, the shift in the balance of power was completed. Domitian ruled like a lord rather than a first citizen. He selected equestrians to administer rather than the Senate, and worst, he didn't pay respect to their special place in society. The culmination of the trend in the first century is clear. Domitian had great power and great independence of that power. The Senate's power and responsibilities were reduced to its lowest extent yet. Things would be neater if we could cut the century off right here. Nerva's acclamation by the Senate after Domitian's death was a clear aberration from the trend I've just described. Here was a princeps that was chosen not by the people, not by the praetorians, not by the legions in the field. The Senate alone had chosen Nerva. I think, though, that this is a break from the trend rather than a breaking of the trend. It was a last gasp of pent-up senatorial energy after the years under Domitian. If the Senate had held more power in the Roman mind of the time, though, the Senate's choice would have been accepted by the army, the praetorians, and the people. But what really happened is that the people shrugged their shoulders and accepted Nerva. The praetorians turned their backs and counted the donatives he had given them. And the legions never officially accepted this princeps placed upon them by the Senate. By the end of the first century, they were used to being the ones, collectively, who called the shots. The cracks in the mask held over the military dictatorship that was Rome were becoming more and more apparent. Part 3. Offense or defense? Was that military focused more on conquest or defensiveness? My knee-jerk reaction was to say defense. Maybe knowing a little of what lies ahead for the empire and comparing that to the relentless expansion of the late Republican period has led me astray. When I actually wrote out all of what had been conquered this century, it's a fairly substantial list. Let's start with evidence that the Roman Empire had shifted from expansion to protecting what it already controlled. As usual, we'll begin with Augustus. He had been focused on finding natural borders for the empire, Ones without enemies lurking nearby. Ones that would be easy to defend. A desert, an ocean, or a large river would be best. When the Romans were kicked out of Germania Magna by Arminius in 9 AD, it's telling that Augustus did not immediately try to reconquer the area. Instead, he sent Tiberius to secure the border and started the construction of forts to defend the crossings of the Rhine River. On the opposite end of the century, we have Domitian further building up the defenses of the Rhine and constructing the limes, that series of walls, forts, and ditches meant to deter crossing into Roman territory at the most vulnerable points. Next in the column of evidence for a defensively focused posture is the war with the Parthians in Armenia. The general Corbulo had been sent to resolve a situation within the kingdom and exert Roman influence. But he was not there to conquer. He did station Roman soldiers in the Armenian capital city, but they were there only briefly, more as a bargaining token than a beginning of annexation. And then what happened next? When the war kicked back up and the Parthians put their full focus on Armenia, where was Corbulo? Not back in Armenia conquering. He was making the defenses of Syria impenetrable to invasion. He was successful, but this defensive focus lost Rome a measure of influence in Armenia, as the Parthians were able to take the initiative and come out on top there. Under Domitian, the Romans were on the defensive against the Dacians and the three tribes, the Iazyges, the Marcomanni, and the Quadi, who invaded across the Danube River into Roman territory. Domitian and the legions pushed both the three tribes and the Dacians out of Pannonia and Moesia, respectively. Then, when the Romans did follow the Dacians across the Danube into Dacia, they weren't there to conquer, but merely to secure peace. That last sentence has to be said a little bit tongue-in-cheek, because under Trajan, the region of Dacia would be conquered by the Romans. So those were the examples of a defensive posture, but I think the examples of expansion are more compelling. First, we have the expansion into the far southwest of the Mediterranean, into Mauritania, under first Caligula and then Claudius. Lots of expansion occurred under Claudius. He annexed most of the client kingdoms which were on the periphery of the empire, Mauritania, Thrace, Lycia, and Noricum. Of course, though, the invasion of Britannia was the most glorious conquest of Claudius. Beginning in 43 AD, the southeastern third of the island was conquered. Over the next four decades, the Romans slowly expanded west into Wales and north into Scotland, culminating with Agricola, yes, Agricola, not Agricola, as I've been saying, culminating with Agricola's conquests to the tip of Scotland in 83 and 84. This was not an insignificant expansion. And now we are back to Domitian, who himself conquered a small but useful territory in the elbow of land where the headwaters of the Rhine and Danube nearly meet. The area was coveted for its strategic defensive position. It was used for defense, but it still counts as conquest. So those were the conquests of the first century, a fairly substantial amount of territory added to the empire. And under Trajan, during the next two decades, we will see Rome reach her maximum size. If we were to draw our century line in 119 instead of 99, I think we would certainly have to say that Rome was still an expanding power. The following centuries, though, are a different story. Finally, in this section, let's take note of the change in dynasties. The first two-thirds of the century were ruled by the Julio-Claudian family, Augustus, Tiberius, Caligula, Claudius, and Nero. The remainder was ruled by the Flavians. Under the Julio-Claudians, succession never followed from father to son. But under the Flavians, succession was exclusively from Vespasian to sons. And Nerva initiated a new dynasty. Rome was blessed during the first century with many emperors who served for a prolonged period of time. If you count all of Augustus's years, even the ones that were in BC, emperors reigned on average 17 years. If you exclude Augustus from that list, the average drops to 8.5 years. But again, that number does include the three emperors of 69 AD who all reigned for less than 1 year. With them and Augustus excluded, the average rises to over 10 years. That's not a short period of time to rule, and this provided stability in the empire. Notable, though, is how many emperors faced a violent end. All right, quiz time. Which of the emperors died of natural causes in the first century? Augustus, probably. Tiberius, probably. Vespasian. Titus. Oh, and Nerva. And who faced a violent end? Don't forget the emperors of 69 AD. Four emperors were assassinated or killed. Caligula, Galba, Vitellius, and Domitian. And two committed suicide, Nero and Otho, though both would have been killed if they had not done the deed themselves. 11 emperors total, and six of them died at knife point. Life was dangerous at the top. That's it for this time. I'll be back shortly with a second end-of-century episode covering listener questions. Thanks for listening. I'll see you next time.